Hello, my name's Pauline Thomas. I'm one of the lecturers at Worcester College of Technology. I teach mostly key skills, a little bit of hairdressing, and a great deal of health and safety. So we thought we'd let you know today about the hazards that you can find in a salon. And because part of our job is to keep students, staff, and clients safe in a salon, we thought we'd show you some things that are good practice and other things which definitely you don't need to do if you want to keep safe. I'll introduce you to Sam and Maria. They're dressed in their uniform. I'm in one of the uniforms that we wear. And I wanted to show you some of the things that you shouldn't do when you're working in a salon. One of the things is I've got trainer type shoes on, which are really not a good idea because you have very little contact with the floor. And even though this is a non-slip area, you can have some nasty falls through having things like the length of the trousers is far too long, and what happens is that the trouser leg gets caught under the shoe and then you have virtually no grip at all. This is a better example. Even though the trouser is too long, at least the shoes are flat, they've got a rubber sole, and they're unlikely to slip, so that's a good thing. Another thing you wouldn't wear is you're often tempted to wear jewellery. If you've got anything dangling like this, the danger is that it can get caught in a client's hair and provide an unhappy experience for the client, because you know they don't want to get their hair tangled in your jewellery. Another thing as well is long necklaces. They're also a hazard because they can get caught on clients' hair. They can also get caught on door handles and give you a nasty shock. If you start walking in one direction, you get caught and then you're pulled back. Similarly, we all wear our uniform done up. We don't have any gaping areas that again can catch on anything and cause us to have any unhappy experiences. If you look around the salon now, you'll see some things that again you wouldn't wear. You wouldn't wear any open-toed shoes or shoes with a heel. Again, for the same reason, you can get your foot caught underneath something, and again it can happen that you have trips and spills. More working days are lost through accidents at work, through trips and spills, than any other hazard. We've got some hair here on these brushes. Obviously our brushes are used a lot and inevitably they pick up hair from the client. But one thing a client would hate to do is see you approach their hair with a brush that's got obviously bits of hair from another client. It's like sitting down to a table, I think, where there's some crockery and stuff and obvious signs of someone just having had a meal and no one's bothered to clear away. So what we should do is remove all the hair from the brush after each time it's used, and then what we do is we put it in a sterilising cabinet which has a UV light in it, and as long as the hairbrush has been washed and is free from hair, 10 minutes in the UV cabinet will help to kill off any germs that might be attached to the brush. And that we do with all kinds of brushes, anything that's not really suitable to go into the barbicide. Another thing we have here, Sam, if you show the barbicide, that shows you barbicide that's ready for clients, for combs to go into. We don't put metallic things in there because they could rust, but we certainly like to clean our combs and put the combs in there to sterilise. If you look along the floor, you'll see hazardous things on the floor. This is where someone's done a haircut. And the rules are that you, having done the haircut, you sweep up the hair before you actually blow dry their hair. But clearly they've been in a hurry and they've not done that, so potentially the client could get up and have a really nasty experience at the end of the session by falling on the floor, which has happened and is highly embarrassing for the client apart from, or a member of staff, apart from the injury that they could suffer. Another thing we've got over here is a hairdryer plugged in, and what we must ensure, a bag on the floor, which obviously is a no-no. A client can actually catch their leg in that, or their foot rather, and again trip over. When you've been blow drying someone's hair, it's so easy to forget to put the dryer back onto the dressing table unit and put the cable out of the way. If we left it on the trolley, for instance, and then the client turned around and went to get up, again they'll pull the dryer off, maybe catch their leg in it and really hurt themselves. You can see someone's had a water bottle and discarded it. They've obviously used the water and not bothered to put it in the bin or anything. It's on the floor. You can see plugs here that are just loose. They should be actually plugged into the ground. We've got sockets in the floor, but they've been left, so again, that's another hazard. Another thing that we need to ensure is that people don't injure their backs when they're working here. And carrying towels like this to and from the laundry is a prime example of how they can end up injuring their back and having long-term damage from not using the wheelie bins. So this is looking at manual handling. When I was referring to the basket of towels, which, yeah, we've got baskets which we use on the floor just to collect any towels that are in use before the wheelie bins are brought back. But we bought these wheelie bins. When students first come to us, they tend to think these are for the rubbish, but they're not actually there to put the used towels in. And then we transport them to and from the laundry using the wheels rather than picking up a basket, which can injure your back. Another thing I need to talk to you about is PPE, which is personal protective equipment. We use a lot of chemicals via a little bowl and brush like this. Certainly colour, we apply a colour to a client's hair. And unless we protect ourselves by using gloves and an apron, what will happen is that the skin will absorb some of the peroxide and colour products. And over time, it weakens your nails and can cause, you know, quite a lot of discomfort there. So Maria's going to demonstrate what we use to protect ourselves. Yes, we've got a uniform on, and you might think, well, it doesn't matter if that gets splattered with chemicals. It will rot the material and fade it as well over time. So this is an example of good practice where Maria's using an apron to keep herself covered and not suffer any chemical damage to her clothes. And she also is putting gloves on, which we wear when we're applying colours, rinsing off colours, applying perm lotion and neutraliser, which is another process that happens during the salon. And you can see that she's well protected now, because one of the dangers to the skin is that you can get dermatitis, which is, you know, raised bumps, itchy skin, which develops further and can also, over time, if it's not treated, it could end your career in hairdressing, because it's a non-infectious skin condition, but it's very painful and can weep, etc. Okay. Another hazard you can see over here is a drinks bottle. Someone has brought it in with them, and we really discourage people doing that, because as you can see, we've got chemicals here, and what could happen is that someone gets chemicals on their gloves or on their hand, transfer it to the drinks bottle, and then when they have a drink, or the client could pick it up, and they can have ingest the product, which can give them a lot of problems with their health and certainly their mouth area. So that's not to be encouraged, so we'll get rid of that. Okay, shall we sweep up, girls? Just sweep up the hair now so that we wouldn't have... So you've seen quite a lot of things that are what our poor practice, so in a minute we'll show you some good practices as well. This is another example of poor practice in the salon, where someone's done a perm on a client and they've left their used end papers in the trolley, so that the next person who goes to use this will find they can't use it because it's still got the perm lotion bottle, the plastic cap that was used over the curlers, and even another product that needs to be mixed. So that is not a good example of how we should treat our salon equipment. Similarly with the rollers, you've got hair all on the rollers, and again that could pass on cross-infection to another client if the previous client had something wrong with their scalp that we were unaware of. So we would clean those up and have those in a nice tidy section of the trolley. That's a better example of what we'd hope to see in a trolley, not rollers covered in hair, but rollers that are clean. Okay, so you can see now that Sam is cleaning up the floor and it's beginning to look much better. And we would put the hairdryer into the socket provided, tuck the cables away, and then when the client went to stand up, we'd turn them away from the cable so that when they get up, they're not going to have any hazard immediately in front of them. We're just looking at good and bad practices now with regard to hygiene, personal hygiene, and Sam is actually just working on Maria's hair, and we work with grips and pins quite a lot when we're doing put-ups. And one of the things that invariably people do when they're not used to working with pins and grips is to put it in their mouth, and it's a really bad habit, because if the pins and grips have been used on someone else's hair, and then you pick a grip up and you actually put it in your own mouth, you're not only endangering your teeth a little bit, but also you could pass an infection from someone else into your mouth, which is pretty unpleasant. Also looking at the way Sam is working, when she reaches for a grip, she'll be working across instead of having the trolley on the right-hand side or the left-hand side, which is most convenient to her, so that she's got her work tools in a good position. So we're talking a little bit about hygiene here and a little bit about posture as well, because when you're on your feet for a long time, several hours a day, the way you work makes a difference to how you feel at the end of that. If you don't have your tools where you need them and you're reaching across all the time, you could strain your back. We've got an adjustable chair here which Sam can use if she finds the client's at the wrong height, which is another useful thing, because if you don't do that kind of thing, what can happen is you get backache from leaning over your client because they're at the wrong height for you. Okay, so good practice would be then not to use your mouth when you're trying to open a grip. Sam's showing you the correct way now by using the fingers on the other hand to open it, and she's got the trolley just where she needs it. Okay, so she's not straining her back or her side trying to reach tools and equipment, and you can see there she managed the job just as easily by using her fingers rather than the teeth. I'd like to talk a little bit about cosh. You'll hear that a lot while you're on the course. It's control of substances hazardous to health. A lot of the things that we use in a hair salon are hazardous if we breathe them in, if we get them on our skin, etc. And we gave you an example of wearing gloves and an apron. But it isn't just using the product, it's how we store it and how we dispose of it as well. One of the things that we have to do all the time is recognise that things are harmful to us if we breathe them in. If we apply colours to clients without skin testing first, they can have an allergy to the product and their face can swell up. There's been a lot in the press lately about people who've used home colours, which are generally a little bit weaker than the products we use in the salon, but they can have a client can have an unhappy experience where they swell up. So we do a test on a client, which is applying a little bit of colour to the area behind the ear, and we leave that for about 48 hours. If the client doesn't have any allergic reactions, then we can go ahead and colour. But we still have to protect ourselves with the gloves and apron. And also for us, the storage of the products is really, really important. According to the COSH regulations, we must follow the manufacturer's instructions, not mix up colours as we think they should be mixed, but follow the ratio of peroxide and colour, etc., according to what the manufacturers recommend, because they've tried and tested the product. If we use it in any other way, it can be very unsafe for ourselves and for the clients. But when we store the products, we mustn't store peroxide higher than shoulder height. If we store it up here and it's on a high shelf and we go and reach it down or it falls down, it could has the potential to spill on us, on our colleagues, you know, on our skin, our face, etc. And as I said, some of the products are quite strong, so you know, it's something we need to look at in the storeroom. Posture is important. If you look at, for a moment, how Sam was standing just then, if you move from behind the chair a moment, Sam, she crossed her legs. She stood with her legs crossed like this. It's something that we all do, you know, quite innocently, but again, it can twist your hips. It can, over time, really affect you. If you stand more on one knee than the other, you'll find that your knees will ache after a while. But really, what we must do when we're cutting a client's hair is to, as far as possible, sit down on a stool, adjust it so that we're at the right height for the client. There will come a time when you'll have to stand up when you're cutting the top of the hair, but cutting stools, some people seem a little bit reluctant to use them, but over time they will save long-term injury to the top of the spine, so they are to be recommended. So Sam has learnt to, she's been here for a year now, like Maria, so she's learnt the things that are good and the things that are not so good to do. What have you found strange, you, Sam? Have you found anything in particular that gives you more aches and pains than you would normally expect to have?
Backache at the top from leaning
over.
And also arm ache, where you're using it a lot.
Yeah.
So I on your knees, so I keep bending it.
Yes.
You're not doing it properly.
Yeah. Okay, and apparently if you're standing for a long period of time, if you just go up onto your toes, which you might think, oh, someone will see me and it'll look silly, but if you do that, it just helps the circulation in the ankles, which is something to be considered, because if you're standing on your feet for several hours a day, what happens is all the blood stagnates around the ankles, your ankles can swell a little bit, and you know, when you go to walk off anyway, you know, you think, oh dear, I ache from the you know, from the knee down, really. But yeah, so posture is important. The way you sit and stand and work really is important. Obviously over time your muscles build up and you don't ache quite as much, but yeah.